Good evening. I'm honored to be here with you tonight here in the beautiful community in London. After dealing with the public for 19 years, almost every night for about 5,000 events, you know, they said, "En chacham ela kebal nisayon." The experience of life that a person gets, it's even more than his wisdom. Whatever he learned, the experience helped him more in life than what he learned, actually. Same thing, it says, "Gadol shimusha milimuda." Someone that was attached to a big chacham, big rav, is higher than someone who learned theoretically the Torah. Why? Because he sees actions every day, what to do, what not to do, how to behave. Why I start my lecture with this? Because I came, they told me, you know, you have to meet Rabbi Doron, he's a very special person. Hashem already gave me, after so many years of experience, that I speak to a person 20 seconds, and I already feel him. So I spoke with him now 1 minute, and I already feel how lucky you are, Baruch Hashem. It's zchut. Zchut that Be'ezrat Hashem, you have such a rav here, Ashrechem. Anyway, tonight we decided to speak about something we all need. Is Torah and Derech Eretz. It sounds like two different topics, Torah and Derech Eretz. But really it's one. Why it's one? There is an expression in Gemara, Ha Beha Talia. One is depend on the other. It's no Derech Eretz without Torah, and it's no Torah without Derech Eretz. One depend on the other. One cannot survive without the other. Everybody knows the expression Derech Eretz Kadma La Torah. The secular Jews in Israel, they love this sentence very much. Why? It makes them feel great about themselves. Why it makes them feel great? Many of them know that the way they live, it's not according to the Torah. They're traditional, they believe in the Torah, thank you. They believe in the Torah, they believe in Hashem, many of them. But they're not in a mood to keep, for whatever reason. It's too difficult, you know. Everyone with his own reasons. So when they catch someone, what we call Haredi, ultra-orthodox, doing something wrong when it comes to manners, it makes them feel very good about themselves. Like in Hebrew, there is a say, it's called Tzarat Rabim Chatzi Nechama. I'm not the only one in problem. I'm better than him. But that's really not a good idea. Why? Maybe you're better than him. Possible. Maybe he's doing bad things and you're doing less bad things than him. It's possible. But that's not, it's not going to bring you to any success. Looking at people that they're on the way down and feeling great about yourself that you're also on the way down, but everyone is on the way down, is not going to bring you anywhere. If you go to medical school and they read that everyone fell, you're the first one that they read your name. Moshe Cohen, 40. Uy. 5 years of learning went down the tube. Yitzhak Levi, 42. Shalom Leibovitz, 39. Yaakov Mizrachi, 45. I'm not the only loser, not bad. But the question is, what did it help you? Does it change your life? Is it going to make you a better doctor? Are you going to be a doctor? No, you're going to clean the street. Tomorrow morning you have to find a job. What happened with the 5-6 years in medical school? Waste of life. So there's no such thing, Tzarat Rabim Chatzi Nechama. What is it? Tzarat Rabim Nechama Tipshim. Tzarat Rabim, when many people are in problem, it's comfort for the fools. Smart person, it's not a comfort for him. The opposite, he feels even worse that other Jews failing. I remember when I was in the beginning of my way. So, you know, every person has some kind of jealousy in his heart. Some people jealous with money. Some people jealous with wisdom, some people jealous with beauty, some people jealous with homes, with material. Everyone jealous with something, depend how much he's desiring it. Materialistic people, they desire materialistic things. Wise people, they desire wisdom. And it's kosher to be jealous when it comes to chokhmah. Chokhmat sofrim, tarbe chokhmah. If you're jealous with a big chacham, big rav, ach, I wish I was like him. Look at me, look at him. I'm a monkey compared to him. If a person think like this, it's very good. It's very encouraging. Why? If you're jealous with him, maybe one day you'll be half of him. If you're not jealous with him, you won't even be 10% of him. Because there's no urge, no rush. You're not in a competition with anyone. Most of the people who make money, it's because they're in competition with someone. This is how it goes. The wife comes, Moshe, what's going to be the end with you? Look at all your friends. 20 years you're in business, we live in this tiny apartment. Look at Yitzchak, $5 million mansion. Look at Shalom, look at this, and we the same. What's going to be? When are you ever going to do something? I'm tired of this. She gives him motivation. He has no choice. He has to make it. The pressure, he begins to kill himself. Eventually, sometimes he succeeds. Same thing in Chochmah. A kosher wife, not Eshet Korach. Eshet Korach told her husband, look, you're a millionaire. Moshe Rabbeinu is a shepherd. You are a billionaire. You're just as smart as him. You have the same yichus. What's going on here? I'm tired of this politics. Politics didn't start this generation. It was right away. As soon as that Hashem came to speak, already politics. 250 against one. We want you to prove to us that you and your brother should run the show. What do you mean? Didn't you hear Hashem nominate me to be the leader just a few days ago? What's on your mind? You heard the voice of God speaking to me. He did not speak to you. Few days after, already politics. They heard Hashem speaking to him. Still, it's a problem for them. But today, Hashem doesn't speak to the rabbis as often as he spoke to Moshe. You know? So it's very hard to know who Hashem speaks to, who Hashem does not speak to. I have as a goy that he's convinced that Hashem is speaking to him every day. So every day I get a detailed email what Hashem told him this day. I wish it was true, because in these emails I come very good. Based on his conversation with Hashem, I'm a very important person, but it's only illusion. In illusion, he thinks he speaks to Hashem, I don't know. But he writes to me a conversation that he has every day with Hashem. It's beautiful. If it was only true, he speaks beautiful Musar, mamash like a Navi, words of the prophets, non-Jew. But yes, he lives in his own world and he comes with all these beautiful conversations that he has with Hashem. But we have to live in reality. Illusions won't get us anyway. So it starts, Derech Eretz Kadma LaTorah. So all the secular people right away translate it. You see? Manners is more important than Torah. It comes before the Torah. The answer, wrong. That's not what it means. Who can tell me in Lashon HaKodesh, what does it mean, Derech Eretz? What's Derech Eretz mean? Derech Eretz, in literal explanation, is the way of the land. What does it have to do with manners? Maybe it's the way to make roads. Maybe it's the way to establish an army and train them. Maybe it's to make IRS to collect taxes. What does it mean, Derech Eretz? Maybe it's to build buildings, to make streets, to build bridges. What does it mean, Derech Eretz Kadma LaTorah? The answer is, people think that until the Torah was given to the Jewish nation, the world was tov avoh, a zoo. Isha yashar be'enav yaseh. Everyone does whatever he feels like. That's not exactly the case. 2,400 years, there were countries, there were nations, there were kings. There's the law of the land everywhere. In every country, there's laws. You have to pay, you have to make roads, you have to participate. If there's an army, you have to be a soldier. What do you think? What happened until the Torah was given? What, the goyim did not have laws? They didn't have judges? We see in the Torah that they had a court in Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah. They already had, before the Torah was given, they had a court. Very bad court. But they had a court. And the rest of the world, they also have laws. Based on what they judge the people? Based on human logic. Human logic. Until today, the goyim, the Gentiles, they're one of the seven laws that God gave Noah after the flood is to make a court and police to watch and supervise society, that people won't eat each other alive, that they'll have rules. And the foundation of the rules of the Gentiles, God gave them seven laws. But they have about 40. If you count all their laws, it's more. But seven main ones. And the Gentiles are obligated to keep every mitzvah that it's required by common sense. As decency. Decency. For instance, you should not kill. You don't need Torah for it to know you should not kill. Well, you kill a person, you destroy the family. Everyone knows it. You need Torah for it. Well, before the Torah, people did not know it's bad to kill. Of course they know it's bad to kill. You should not steal. You need Torah for it? No. You should not torture the animal. You don't need Torah for it. It's decency. But there's also laws that the Torah does not speak about, like don't make the roads dirty. Don't eat your chocolate and throw the paper on the floor. It doesn't say it in the Ten Commandments. But it's required by common sense for Jews and non-Jews. Don't hit your friend on the street. It doesn't say it in the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. But it's obvious, it's common sense. They have to have decency as human. They're not animals. Every animal teaches us something in a creation. The Gemara in Masechet Eruvin says, Ilmale nitna Torah, Ainu lemedim derech eretz me'achatul ve'me'atarnegol. If the Torah was not given, we would have to learn from the animals how to behave. First two we would have to start to learn how to behave from was the chicken, the rooster, and the cat. What can you learn from them? Every animal can teach you something. What can you learn from the cat? When the cat finish to eat and they need to go to the bathroom, they do their bathroom somewhere and right away they cover it with the sand. Who told the cat that it's logical to cover their waist with their back legs to cover it with sand, that other people won't be disgusted? Why they cover it? They never got Torah. They don't know what's decent, what's not. They don't have free choice. How they know to cover what they did? Hashem gave every species something unique about them for us to learn. If we would not have Torah, we would still be able to learn how to behave from the animals. What can you learn from the rooster? The rooster is a wonderful husband, much better than most of us. Why? Why? Now you're going to see how the women begins to smile in a minute. Why? The rooster never forces his female to have intimate relationship with him. Only if she's in a good mood for him. So when she's not in a good mood, she had a hard day in the kitchen, you know. So he comes around, he makes a show, until she smiles. Then when she smiles, he says, no, you agree now to be with your husband? She smiles a little more. Until he's convinced that she's in a good mood for him, then he comes and they have intimate relationship. That's what the Torah say. A person is not an animal to come and attack right away. No, he didn't come to the world just to use the world and attack and fulfill your needs and desires. You're a human being. You're not an animal. Even an animal can teach you how to behave. But Baruch Hashem, Rabbi Yochanan already solved us that mystery, that problem. What did he say? Ilmale nitna Torah. If the Torah would not have been given, all we had to do is to learn from the animals how to behave. Shlomo HaMelech, prior to him already, at least 1,000 years before Rabbi Yochanan, he already said, Lech la nemala atzel. Go and see how the ants behave. They live 6 months, and they need 1.5 pieces of wheat to live. One seed of wheat, you know, these wheats that you put in a chulent or barley, one little tiny one. The entire life of the ant is 1.5. That's what it consumes. 1.5. But the ant works nonstop, accumulating more and more and more and more and more. There's something interesting about them. While they're dragging the wheat to a place where they're putting all their, whatever they find, they make a pile, sometimes it falls on the way. Like sometimes they try to take more than one, and one falls, so they finish with the one, and then they come back to take it. Every ant that comes and see the one, it comes and feel right away that a different ant already touched it before. They don't touch it. They don't touch it. Why? They don't steal. They don't steal from one another, but they steal from the whole world. But from another, they live in harmony, like Ahav and his army. They're all wicked people, but they're united. The people that built the Babylonian tower, they had rotten ideology. What's their ideology? Let's make a tower that can go and fight against God. That's very rotten ideology. Even the Goyim agree. Why they were successful almost? Because they're united. Hashem said, let me confuse them. I changed their languages. They started to hit each other. He said, give me the hammer. He didn't understand. He thought, bang me on my head. And they started to have fights. So, what can you learn from a mouse? The Gemara say, Achbarim rish'i ninu. Achbarim, they're very wicked. They're wicked to us, but they're very good to each other. There's something we can learn from them. What? I'll ask you a question. If a person walk on the street, somewhere in the forest, and he found a hole in the ground full of diamonds, lots of, a mine full of diamonds, or gold, whatever you want, something precious, treasure. It's enough for him to live 5,000 years. Not 70 years, 5,000 years. What do you think this person would do? He would run to call all his friends, hey guys, come see what I found. Come, it's an opportunity, follow me. Or he would make sure to cover it with branches and everything and make signs that he's going to be the only one who comes and take whenever he needs. Even though there's plenty over there for 50 people, not one. What do you think he would do? He would share it with everyone? Or he make sure he hides it that even his own children won't know? What do you think? Huh? The Gemara say the mouse, when they discover the pile of dough, the wife prepared dough, afrashat chala. Oh, one of the mouses came out. Oh, he found it. What's the first thing he does? He ran to call all his friends. A minute later, he has 50. All over. They ran and called their friends. The Gemara say, chasida. Why chasida, call chasida? Mishum she'osa chesed im chavroteah. It's very kind. It helps their friends very much. Like Atzala organization, Chaverim, whatever you need, you just call and they run away, volunteer and help. You want to give them money? No, absolutely not. We do it for the mitzvah, no problem. So the Gemara asks, in that case, why Chasida, it's an impure bird, should have been kosher. They have a sign of kashrut. It says no. To do chesed only to your own kind, it's worse than not to do chesed at all. That means you're racist. Racist is not a kosher human being. Whether he's a Jew, whether he's a non-Jew, it's no place in life for racism. Yes, it's true that the Torah said there are some people are more important than the other, like a Kohen. More important than me. I don't kill myself over it. This is what Hashem wanted. End of story. So it's more important. He come from a royal family. Levi, next one on the list. Israel, next one on the list. So there's a list. Even among the nations, some Gentiles consider better than others in their nature. Everyone with his free choice can reach the highest level. The Gemara says even a Kohen, even a Goy that learned Torah, can reach a level of Kohen Gadol Bebet HaMikdash. The Gemara says, Goy Shasak BaTorah, I don't know, it looks like a contradiction because the Goyim not allowed to learn Torah in general. I asked one time a Talmid Chacham, how does it work out? That on one hand, the Goyim not allowed, the Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin, page Nun Chet, Nun Tet, speaking about things the Gentiles are not allowed to do. So two things the Gemara there mentioned. One, they're not allowed to keep Shabbat, because it's an eternal covenant between God and his children forever. And they're also not allowed to learn Torah. And they are subject to a serious punishment if they violate those two rules. Think about it. A goy wants to keep Shabbat. He wants to love Hashem and to keep the covenant. He wants to be righteous. He doesn't want to murder. Doesn't want to rape. Doesn't want to steal. He wants to be a decent person. You see that Hashem loves Shabbat. And it's a very precious thing for Hashem. So he comes and he wants to keep Shabbat, even though he's not obligated. We would think, not only deserve a reward, it deserves a reward even more than the Jew. The Jew is obligated. This is your job. You have to do it. You're working here. Someone from the street saw that the bagel store is very busy. And he saw they don't have enough help. So he walked in to help. His friend owned the store. So he worked here for 3 hours, not for money, to help. And someone who works there every day, that's his job. Who deserves bigger credit? The one has to work every day or the one who came volunteer when he didn't have to? So imagine the owner of the bagel store telling by the end of the day, I'm very sorry, I didn't tell you to come help. I'm penalizing you $100 or more. What would people say? What's going on here? He comes to help, he wants to do good, and you give him a punishment? What's the difference between the bagel store story and the Torah? In the bagel store, he didn't know if he comes to help, he gets penalty. If he knew, he wouldn't come. That's the reason why when someone comes to help, if he made a damage, he's dismissed from a punishment. If somebody had a fire in his home, and you walk inside, and you took water, and you spill it on it, and then there was a Persian antique rug from 300 years ago that worth $1 million. You don't know. What do you know about rugs? So there was fire. If you wait 20 more minutes, the fire department will come, so the whole unit would go to the garbage, $10,000 damage. But now you made $1 million damage. He cannot sue you in Beit Din. You're dismissed. Why? Because if people would know they are subject to penalty by coming to help, no one would come to help. First thing happened to me when I arrived to America in 1989. I finished the army. A few days later, I was already in New York. When my father's friend picked me up from the airport, I'll never forget it. It was 24 years ago, 1989. On the way to home from the airport, half an hour ride, he told me, rule number one in this country. I say, yes, rule number one. He said, if you see a person had an accident, heart attack, whatever the case is laying down on the street, never, ever come to help him. Never dare to help him or to touch him. Be very careful. I said to him, what? I was thinking that I came to Sodom and Gomorrah, I see. That's the law of Sodom. So I said to him, what do you mean? He said, if you come and help him and you try to be tzaddik, a week later, you're going to get $1 million lawsuit from him that is paralyzed because of you, and you're going to lose in court. This is how stupid this country is. So don't be a big shot. Let him die and pretend you don't see, otherwise you die. There was a Talmid Chacham. Chayecha Kodmim. Baruch Hashem, a year ago, they changed this stupid law. And if you come to help a person in times of problems, accident, you're not subject to lawsuit. Finally, somebody clever did what needs to be done 50 years ago. But he was right. He was right. You come to save life, and in the end, you lose your home. You lose everything. Why? Because this guy will take advantage on you, because most people are ungrateful people. He doesn't think this guy came to help me. Fine, he made me a damage, but he came to save my life. How can I sue him? That's the idea here. So we're going back to what we started with. What can you learn from the horse? Horse. Two things. Horse, why his name is Sus? Sus, Chazal say, Sas Lakrav, is a very good soldier. You want to join the army? Look at the horse first, how they run into the fire. They enjoy the battle. Sas Lakrav. Sus is happy to go to war. That's why it says in Az Yashir Moshe, Sus Verochbo Ramav Hayam. The horse enjoy the fight. It's different than other animals you force them to do. What else do you learn from Sus? It's Midrash Talpiot. It says, one time they took a horse. The guy made an experiment, and they put a sack on his head. And they brought the horse to be intimately with his own mother. But he doesn't see it's his mother, because they put a bag. And while they were together, they took the bag out of his face, and he realized that it's his own mother. He got up, and he started to run, until he got to the cliff, and he jumped and committed suicide. That's what happened. It's written in Midrash Talpiot, more than 1,000 years, I believe. So even a horse that doesn't have a free choice, doesn't know the law of intimacy, what's forbidden, what's not forbidden, they don't have Gilui Arayot. Other animals have no problem doing it. But the horse is teaching us some of the things the Torah says it's forbidden. He understands on his own, the horse. So bottom line, every animal can teach us something. But Baruch Hashem, we don't need the animals. And Hashem gave us Torah, everything is ready to go. All we have to do is to learn Torah. So what does it mean, Derech Eretz Kadma LaTorah? That just when you think that before the Torah was given, there was nothing, think again. Every country already had rules. The news in the Torah was that now the Torah doesn't only have laws that apply according to human logic. The Torah have laws that human logic cannot understand. It's above our understanding. So that means we have to count on the creator of the world that he knows better than us what's good for us. He knows better. Even if we do not understand, but we know that our creator knows better for us what's good for us. That's the rule. If you trust him that he gave you the right advice, you will never lose. He tells you don't mix chalav and basar. Why really? There's many all kinds of theories. We will never know. He told us, you see a nest and there's a bird inside. You walk in the street and you see some little babies, chicks there in a nest. You get rid of the mother. First you send the mother. That the mother doesn't see you take the children away. And then even 100 times the mother keeps coming back. You keep sending her until she leaves. Then you take them and you put them somewhere. And thanks to that you'll have long life. But not just long life in the afterlife. La'olam shekulo aruch, such a huge reward. At the same time, it tells us that kabed et avicha ve et imecha, respect your father and mother, leman ya'arichun yamecha. The same reward for getting rid of the bird, which takes 5 minutes, to 40 years of avodat parech, to respect the parents, which is the hardest thing to do in life. Especially if your parents are not easy people. Do this, do that, woof, this. Why are you too religious? Why are you this? Why are you that? Why are you not coming here? Why are you not going there? Oh. So Chachamim say, you know what's the only way to respect your parents? Is to live far away. Because if you want to live next door to them, you'll never be able to fulfill the mitzvah. So the Gemara brings examples of Chachamim, how they used to speak to respect their mother. I believe it was Rabbi Tarfon, if I remember correctly. He used to put his legs, his hands on the floor, and his mother did not have shoes. That she walks on his hands, that her feet won't hurt. And then when they come to the bed, He goes like this, and she step on his back to climb on a bed. Such a kavod. Or all kinds of things like that. They give an example. So the Gemara says, after all this amazing kibud orim, it's nothing compared to Esav, how he respects his father, Esav. So the Gemara says, what's the solution? It's one of these tests that it's almost impossible to pass. It's one of these tests, very difficult to pass. So if you live in a different country, you're not obligated. One cheap guy came to the rabbi. He said, Rabbi, my father lives in a different city, very far away. And it's more than 10 hours ride. And the halacha said that kaved avicha ve'imecha, kaved avicha mishel avicha. You have to respect your father, but your father has to pay the bills. So it means if your father lives in Israel and he say to you, hey, Moishi, you're not coming to visit us on Pesach? So you tell him, I really want to, I don't have money for the ticket. So the father has to buy you the ticket. If he doesn't want to buy you the ticket, you're dismissed from coming. Even if you have the money, you have, let's say, $5,000 saving, you don't have to burn it on mitzvat kibud avim. Kabed et avicha mishelo. You have to take care of him with his own money. You buy him food with his money. You take care of the food, you bring it from the market, you clean it, you cook it, whatever he needs to do. And he has to pay the bills. So this cheap guy came to the rabbi and said, Rabbi, you know, I have to go all the way to my father now and it's 10 hours ride. So he said, it's going to cost a lot of money. And since I know my father is very, very stingy, he's not going to pay the bill. So that means, Baruch Hashem, I'm dismissed. Huh? So the rabbi is look at him. The rabbi say, have a nice ride. Walk. Walk. Still have to respect your father. Walking, there's no expenses. Walk 3 days. It's called Naval Birshut HaTorah. The Ramban, Rabbi Moshe Ben Nachman, 750 years ago, invented a new term in Judaism. Brilliant. That's it. He's the source. Maybe other people knew it before, but the first time we see in a book somebody used this expression is the Ramban. He called it Naval Birshut HaTorah. A person that all he does is checking the Jewish law. Where can I find loophole that I can cheat legally? I'm going to violate any rules. Come on, I fear God. I love God. I'm not going to go against his instructions. But I found a way out of it. For instance, the Torah says if you're a farmer and you have perot, you have to give maaser. That's if you bring the maaser into the main door, into your home. But if you bring it from the roof, let's say you have these windows on the roof, you climb on the house, and you bring the fruit from the roof, you don't have to give maaser. They found a way for the cheap people to cheat in a legal way. So now, someone who really loves Hashem, he will bring it from the roof, I would bring it from the door. From the door. Yeah, I have a way out. But what does Hashem really want? That I'll give maaser to the poor or no? So what is the poor? Oh, okay, so you have a way to cheat, legally. But that's not what Hashem wants. If you're really a Resh HaMayim, you care, allowed, not allowed. You always want to make Hashem, even when it's allowed. Kadesh atzmecha b'mutar lach. Make yourself holy with what's allowed. Not only what's not allowed, you only stick to the word, words by word. You know, one of the Chachamim, one time he came to Shul, and they're about to start the tefillah. The Chazan got up and started to say Kaddish. So one of the Bachurei Yeshiva was on a roof. So when he heard, Itgadal v'itkadash me rabba, he jumped from the roof right into the Shul. And he landed in the middle of the Shul and screamed, Amen! And then the entire thing, he could have gone around. He didn't want to miss the Kaddish. So he jumped from high right into the Shul. So he said, somebody like this I want for my daughter to be a Chatan. I was very impressed. Okay, you want to date my daughter? No, very good, Mazal Tov. They got married. After they got married, He comes and speaks to him. Everything he speaks to him, he sits like this. Panim tisha be'av. He doesn't answer anything. Sits like this. So the rabbi said, oh, maybe I made a mistake of my life. I ruined my daughter's life. I thought it's a big tzaddik. He jumped, risked his life not to miss amen. What can go wrong with such a guy? Such nirat shamayim, doesn't want to miss one amen? Like this, he doesn't talk, he doesn't talk. He comes to his rabbi, so what's going on? After 40 days, so he said, all of a sudden he started to talk, he gives divrei Torah like a machine gun. Ta-ta-ta-ta. Ishtabach shemo. Wow, he's not mute. He's not dumb. He's brilliant. So he comes to him and says, why did you kill me for 40 days? I talked to you, never answer. He told him, I read in Kabbalah that in order for you to get Ruach HaKodesh, you have to do Ta'anit Dibur for 40 days. 40 days, don't talk. Today the 40 days are finished. So he said, you should have write it on a piece of paper at least. Let's start the lecture. That was the Akdama Lamavo. Now he's starting the introduction. Relax, relax. The Gemara say a few things about people that have bad manners that not only are scary, are shocking. When we read it, there's no way to stay cold and indifferent when you read such a thing. It's really shocking. I'll give you some of them, just what comes to my memory right now. One of the things it says, Talmid Chacham in the time of the Gemara is higher than the level of the chief rabbi in the world today. Just for you to understand what the Gemara called Talmid Chacham 2,000 years ago. Someone that knows every word you ask him, any subject, he knows everything from A to Z. That's what the Gemara means Talmid Chacham 2,000 years ago. Today, you don't have people like this. But in the time of the Gemara, you had many people like this. In a generation of King Chizkiyahu, 2,600 years ago, every kid, 6 years old, knew the entire Torah already. 6 years old. 800 years later, not everyone was like that, but there was hundreds or perhaps thousands like this. So the Gemara said, Talmid Chacham, Shemidotav Ra'ot, that his traits, his behaving, his personality is bad, Nevela sruha bashuk tova mimeno. A dead rat on the street is better than him. Did you ever hear such a thing? You see somebody, wow, he's better than angel, this rabbi. He knows the whole Torah by heart. He knows everything by heart. But he doesn't behave properly. They say not only it's nothing, is worse than a dead rat in the street. What an expression. What happened to the Chachamim? They couldn't find something cleaner? They couldn't say, this Talmid Chacham needs serious improvement. Why do I have to say, dead rat on the street is better than him? Why do you use such a language? No? They're speaking about one of their colleagues. Who are they speaking against? There's many Chachamim, and maybe one or two did not behave. Talmid Chacham that go to the street with a stain on his shirt, lo alenu, chayav mita, doesn't deserve to live for the embarrassment he caused Judaism. When people look at the oil in his shirt, how it's dirty. The Gemara say, Rabbi had a shiur, Rabbi gave a lecture in his yeshiva. And inside the shiur, he smelled that one of the students ate garlic, raw garlic. So he said, someone who ate garlic, please leave the class. So one of the students got up, he's about to leave the class, all the students got up. They didn't want to embarrass him. All of them got up, but in the meantime, he saw who was the first one who got up. So they assume he's the one. The next day, Rabbi's son saw him on the market. And he said to him, shame on you. You're the one that because of you, my father Shiur got canceled. So he told him, Chas v'shalom, God forbid, I didn't eat garlic. So why you got up? I got up because I know if I won't get up quick, the real one would get up and he'll get embarrassment. I'd rather take the embarrassment. It's big zchut to get the embarrassment, especially if you're clean and you're innocent. Choshdim bo bedavar she'en bo. Very good. It's an extra bonus in life. You can make a lot. The question is, why the chief rabbi of Israel that wrote the Mishnah, that the Chachamim say, yesh bo nitzot shel Yaakov Avinu, has the neshama of Yaakov Avinu, and the Gemara asks, who deserves to be Mashiach? Everyone agrees in his generation that he is the number one that should be Mashiach. He also was from Zera David HaMelech, from the royal family of King David. Him, Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel, this is all the family of King David. So if he deserves, he's the person who deserves to be Mashiach, and he's such a perfect human being, and he lived 120 years, and he wrote the Mishnah, and he was a multi-billionaire, he had everything a person wants, everything. So why did he have to embarrass a Talmid that ate garlic? What he should have done, technically, he should have said, someone ate garlic here, I don't care who it is now, please make sure it doesn't happen again and disturb our class. That's it. No? That's what I would do. But he's mechayem etim. We cannot be the dirt of his nail even. Somebody that we have to understand who we're talking here about. Why to do something extreme? Because the nature of people, believe it or not, that they react when something is extreme. When something is normal, they don't take musar. When you do something extreme, they get shocked and they wake up. It's shaking the heart. When they saw the reaction of the Rav, no one would ever do it for the rest of his life. If he only say, don't do it again, for 1 month it would not happen, then it would go back to normal. But after they saw such a reaction, because it says, "Malbin pnei chavero barabim en lo chelek la'olam haba," you embarrass your friend in public, chas v'shalom, you can lose your share to the world to come. It's like spilling the blood of your friend. You know, did you ever realize that if you embarrass a person in public, that the entire face become red? Where the redness come from? The truth is that the red blood cells under the skin explode, and a person really spilling his blood, but the skin keeps it in. It really came out of the system. But the skin keeps it in. If there was a hole in the skin, it would really come out, all the blood. So we see that something spiritual, such as shame, causes a person, first of all, that his body temperature rise right away by a few degrees. Did you ever feel that someone embarrassed you and you feel a wave of heat and you begin to sweat? It happens all the time. Even in 20 below zero, it can happen, that you sweat. What's made you to sweat? Not the weather. It's the shame. Chazal say the biggest punishment in the afterlife is the shame. More than all the physical punishments that they describe. The shame is the worst. Why? Shame, it's a bigger punishment than physical pain. What's the proof? I'll tell you two stories, you understand. If you ever watched in your life a boxing match, when two people hit each other for a few minutes or a few hours until one of them collapse. And you have the audience that is thirsty for blood and everyone that punched his friend, they are more happy. Instead of crying, they smiling and screaming. So what happened over there? Usually, one is winning the fight, usually. So what happened? He gives him a knockout and he falls. So what happened? The referee begins to count until 10. One, two, and everyone scream, stay down, die. So what does he do? As soon as he fall, everybody understands that when you got so many punches to the head, that your life is in a risk. The brain is in a fragile situation right now. Better not to move, wait for the ambulance to come, let them put the ice, let them take you to x-ray, don't move. Who knows, maybe something in the spine and the neck got ripped. It can be a lot of damages. Stay, don't move. Let the doctor examine you. But somehow, all the losers who get the knockdown and they fall down, there's always one thing they always do. They try to stand, they hold the rope, they stand like this, and they wave to the crowd. And an hour later, they died in a hospital. Did you ever think what's going on here? Everyone saw you losing. Why it's so important for you to stand? With all the physical pain, with the life risk, with taking the risk of being paralyzed for the rest of his life, that's all nonsense. There's only one thing in his mind. How do I prevent the 1 minute shame that 10,000 people saw me falling like this? This is the first thing in his mind. He doesn't care about the physical pain. His head is blowing up. Such pain. He gets some kind of energy and he goes like this. I'm still standing. That's one example. One time when I was a kid, in Israel, they used to have a place, it's called Gadnei HaTa'arucha, like amusement park. And over there, they used to bring all kinds of people, and one of them, it's called Kira Mavet. Kira Mavet means it's a round wall, and the motorcycle ride on a wall, like this, on the side. And it goes very fast. One time, I made him Ayin Hara. He's going. I looked at him, I said, cannot be, this guy won't fall. All of a sudden, there was a stain of oil. Up, he fell down. And everyone screamed, no! It was very scary. The whole bike fell, flew. The bike flew, he fell with his helmet. The first thing he did, as soon as he hit his head like this, I don't know how he survived. Right away, he comes like this and pretend that he's smiling. Go like this. Why? Relax 2 minutes. Everyone said, wow, what a loser. He fell down. One time I come to the yeshiva, I see one of the guys dressed like a chatan. In the middle of the day, weekday. I come to him. I say, no, Arik, what's going on? Lechvod ma atachposet. Why are you dressed like this? So I say, probably you have a shiduch. No, you have a date. I say, yes. Where? In Brooklyn. Monsey to Brooklyn is 2 hours with a bus. So I say, no, so you're going to go to, you're going all the way to Brooklyn? Yes. Where are you going to go? He said, to a restaurant. So I said to him, you have enough money? I know, the Bachurei Shiva, they sit and learn Torah. He say, yes. I say, you have enough? You need at least $100, transportation. He told me, yes, the rabbi gave me. The Rosh Yeshiva gave me. So I asked him, this is how it works? Everyone who goes on a date, he comes to the Rosh Yeshiva and he gives him money for the date? He told me, yes, that's how it happened with me. So I told him, what did you feel when the Rosh Yeshiva took money from his wallet and he gave you $100? So he looked at me and said, you know the truth? Horrible. I was very ashamed. Well, what can I do? I need to get married. It's hard without a wife. So I said to him, listen, what if I would bring a machine to the yeshiva? A machine. And now the machine has two hands. You put your head inside, the two hands close on your head like this that you cannot run. And there's a third hand with a boxing glove. It gives you a punch on your forehead. Boom, you get it? And $100 fall on the floor for that punch. Next date, would you go to the rabbi or you go to my machine? So of course I'll go to your machine. So I say to him, I just taught you a very important lesson for life. A person would rather any physical pain than a little embarrassment. The embarrassment is a killer. Sometimes a person wants to make a scene. And a goy, a non-Jew, is running by. How are you doing? He was about to make a scene, and that Gentile was running next to him and looked at him for a second. The Jew got nervous. He said, okay, I won't do the scene today. Someone looked at me, maybe tomorrow here on the news, I don't know. It's embarrassing. You will never see him again. But it's already embarrassing. Then, a week after he came to make the scene, and a little kid came, 2 years old. He looks at him like this. He says, Yeled, Ech Leima, what are you doing here? Go to mommy. And the kid begins to cry. No!
There, go. What are you doing here? Go. No, here, take a candy. Go. He throw the candy over there. He think he's a dog. Maybe he run. Hey, that is a, so he said, what can I do? So he cannot make the scene. Then a week later, he comes to do the scene for the third time. And he see a dog, little ugly dog like this, angry, looks at him. And he said to the dog, get out. The dog, said, get out of here. Ah, you see, the dog is getting angry. So he wants to do it, but the dog is staring at him. He's embarrassed in front of the dog. And then one day he dies. And he comes in front of Hashem. And all of a sudden he hears such a shout. It frees his blood. The video, the DVD, HD, best quality screen. He see 40 years ago. A film. He went to make a scene in some hotel room. And a dog was there, came out of the closet. And the dog looks at him, and he couldn't do it. And now he sees the entire thing. He see how first time he went, the guy say, how are you doing? And he stopped. Next week he came, the little kid looks at him, he stopped. Third time he came, the dog looks at him, he stopped. Then he begins to hear Hashem. Hashem say to him, shame on you. So he looks, he says, well, what did I do? He say, am I worse than a dog for you? From the dog you were ashamed not to make a scene, and alai ata metzafzef 70 shana, and you ignore me for 70 years, I give you oxygen, I give you money, I give you food, I give you chokhmah, I give you refuah, I give you a wife, give you children, give you a car, give you billions of other things. And what did you do with what I gave you? Used it against me non-stop for 70 years with no shame. But when the dog came, you stop right away. That means the dog is more important in your eyes than me. From the dog you're embarrassed, but from me you're not embarrassed. What is the person going to say when it happens? Such a busha, such an embarrassment. It's really to cry when a person think about it. The Torah says, Ayin roa, ve'ozen shoma'at, ve'chol ma'asecha ba'sefer nichtavim. There's the eye of Hashem on you, 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, every second of your life. From the time you crawl on a rug until the last breath you take. You're always filmed. There's the ear who listens to you, and everything you do is registered in the book of Hashem. It's all recorded. One person had a supermarket, and one day he decided to sell it, and he has 10 employees. As soon as the new owner bought the business, 9 of the employees came to resign. Just give me my weekly paycheck and I quit. So he said to them, the new owner, what did I do wrong? I didn't even meet you yet. You're already quitting? Did you hear Lashon Hara about me? What's the story? I'm not going to lower your salary. So they say, no, no, no. So he takes the first one. Tell me why you're quitting. He said, listen, you came here. First thing you did, you put camera in the aisles. We don't want to work anymore. He said, why? Son, listen, I have a problem. I like to pick my nose. Until now, I was looking. Nobody sees. I pick my nose and I, you know. Now you put me this camera in my face. I can't do it. So I quit. I find another supermarket without cameras. The next one comes and says, why are you quitting? He said, listen, I like chocolate very much. But I, you know, I don't have money. I look around, nobody see. I take one of the chocolate, I take some piece, and I put it right back on the shelf. Every day I eat chocolate like this. Now you put me this camera, I cannot do it. Said to the third one, why you want to quit? He said, listen, I'm a very tired person. Between 2 and 4, I have to rest. So now I know 2 and 4, it's not so busy in the supermarket. I go behind, I sleep on the flour bags, these big flour bags. I sleep there. Now you put a camera right there. You want to see, the whole world to see me snoring between 2 and 4. So I had to quit. So everyone had a reason why I had to quit. After all that, one guy stayed. So he said to him, tell me, can you tell me why you're not quitting? He told me, I never did anything wrong. So what do I care? It's, for me, it's good that the camera is here. The camera just proved how great I am. Until now, no one acknowledged me. They all do nothing, and I do all the work, and the boss gives us the same salary. At least, finally, somebody would know that I'm a perfect worker. Told him, Mazal Tov, you're the manager of the store. That's first story. Second story, one time, one rabbi says a story. He said, I came to my house. He lives in Bnei Brak. And in Israel, you have intercom. You know the intercom? You press a button in one of the apartments, and someone pick up the phone. Who is this? Moshe. Buzz. You buzz, and they open the door. Now, what happens if the kids do it and they do not close the phone?
So you hear what?
So the entire neighborhood hears what's happening in that apartment on the phone, on the intercom. You can stand by the intercom and hear everything. So this rabbi say, I was late, it was almost Shabbat. I came quickly home, I ran to the shower, I get ready, I come out of, I go downstairs to go to the shul. Shabbat started already. What do I hear? My wife scream, Yitzchak! Yitzchak, I'll kill you! Where are you? I run quickly outside, shh! Everybody hears you! So he said, the whole Shabbat, we were all mute. Moshe! Finally, I understand what does it mean. There's an eye who watches you and there's an ear who listens to you. How a person has to be careful what comes out of his mouth. How he behaves in Chadre Chadarim. The Torah says there's two things. One is Kiddush Hashem, one is Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem is one of the worst sins in the Torah. Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem is very, very big sin. Baruch Hashem in London, I thought in Israel it's hot, but Baruch Hashem, I come from 10 below zero. Over here it's summer. Everyone's freezing here. Heat on 90 degrees. Baruch Hashem. So, Kiddush Hashem, meaning Lekadesh Shem Shamayim Barabim, to sanctify the name of Hashem in public. This is, by the way, the purpose of life, the purpose of the Jew, Lekadesh Shem Shamayim Barabim. The Rambam explained, what does it mean, Lekadesh Shem Shamayim Barabim? Chachamim says it. Sheyehe Shem Shamayim Mita'ev Al Yadcha. That people love Hashem because of you. Because the way you behave. Let me give you an example of what I mean. As one Baal Tshuva, they asked him, how you became religious? So this is what he said. He said, I was a lifeguard in a pool in a summer. That's my job. In a summer vacation, all kids come to the public pool. One time I went for 20 minutes, and you know, he's the lifeguard, he's in charge of the pool, not lifeguard, in charge. He's sitting in the gate and collecting money. So he said, one time I had to go and I left the place. What can I had an emergency. So when I came back, I saw five Haredi boys. They're standing by the pool, and then they didn't go inside. And then I look inside the pool, I see double amount of kids than when I left. Many kids took advantage that there's nobody. Right away, they sneaked in. When I see these five Haredim kids in elementary school, they're standing by the gate. So I told him, why are you standing here? So we were looking for you. We're almost half an hour waiting for you. What happened? So I told him, you did not go inside? I told him, no. So why? If there's no one here, you should have gone inside. Look, they all went inside. So what? It's stealing. How can we steal? Can I use it without permission? So he said, for the first time in my life, I realized what religion is, how important it is to humanity. And I started to think to myself, I want my kids to be like these kids. If I stay the way I am, my kids will never be like this. There's no chance. So what happened? I started to get involved and to check and to learn, and I became what I became. This is one example. Many times, the Haredim, they do all kinds of gmachim, which means public aid.
lo aleinu, when there's bomb, terrorism, they see them with a beard all over the world. Even the Goyim speaks about it. How these religious Hasidic Jews, they're picking up organs, bodies from the floor. How they do such a job? Middle of the night, he get a call. Hatzala, volunteer, all day walking with his walkie-talkie on his this. Chaverim. That makes a very big Kiddush Hashem. When the people see that, they have a love to the religion. Not only love to the person, love to the religion. There's one very famous, Führer, is very famous in giving advice and setting up people with doctors all over the world. He started as a volunteer and he built an empire that he's giving advice to thousands of Jews every year where to go and save lives on a constant basis. And one time they made a show about him. You should see how the Chilonim was speaking about him. How much love he brings to religion. The problem is that there are hundreds other who makes them hate the religion. One, it's not enough. One here, one there, one there. It should be everyone be like this. That's called Sheyeh Shem Shamayim Mitaev Al Yadcha. And people see how you behave, and they say, someone like you I want to be. And if that's going to be the case, then you're going to have mitzvat zikuy arabim. Kol ha-matzil nefesh achat mi-Israel, ki-ilu itzil olam umlo'o. You come in front of Hashem, and Hashem say to you, you saved seven souls, and from that they became seven families. And now after three generations is 1,000 tzaddikim who sits and learn Torah and do mitzvot. So he said to Hashem, Hashem, you know, I'm very flattered, but I promise you I never save anyone. I never gave lectures. I did not donate CDs. I brought you free CDs, by the way. Take advantage. And I never made lecture in my house. I didn't teach anyone Torah. How did I save souls? I'm religious for myself, yes. I don't remember saving 1,000 souls. So Hashem showed him a movie. You see how you behave one time in a supermarket? You see how one time you held the whole lady? You see how one time there was a fight and you gave up? I'll tell you a story. In Chulon, in Israel, there's a shul. What's the name of the shul? Bet Knesset Igor. Already sounds suspicious. One time I said that story and the guy told me, you sure it wasn't a church? Bet Knesset Igor. Now, until now you laugh, now get ready to cry. So why it's called Bet Knesset Igor? It's named after a dog. It's named after a dog that his name was Igor. Alav Shalom. This Igor was a dog that belongs to one Chiloni in Israel. Chiloni called him Igor. How all of a sudden there's a shul named Igor? One time in Israel in a traffic, the Chiloni was driving with his car and one Haredi, ultra-Orthodox tzaddik, driving behind him. The Chiloni stopped, a sudden stop, and the Haredi accidentally hit him a little bit in the back. He was fuming. He came out of the car to see who did it, and he saw a guy with a beard or yarmulke or hat, whatever the case was. What's wrong with you? You're blind. God started to curse the religious people. He started to slap him, punching him. And the Haredi was getting punched. And he said, thank you, I deserve it. Thank you, you're right, I'm sorry, thank you. He's beating him up, boom, boom, boom. And now he's not fighting back. Not calling the police, nothing. Hit me, you're right, like this. After a few seconds, all of a sudden he stopped. He saw what's going on here. So he said, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. What am I doing? He started to feel guilty because he wasn't resisting. Surrender.
So after a few years, he said, I'm sorry, please forgive me, I overreacted. He said to him, no, you're right, I should have been more careful. I wasn't paying attention enough. And they started to talk, and he said, listen, I'm very sorry, please forgive me. Chiloni, Haredi, he saw such a nice person. So they started to talk. How are you like this? He said, how can you be everybody else? We'll call the police, or at least try to punch me back. It's even my fault. It wasn't your fault. Why are you saying, yes, I deserve it? So he told him, listen, the Torah say, Shomim cherpatam ve'enam meshivim. Someone that listens to someone embarrass him in public and he has what to answer and he decides to be quiet and leave it to Hashem. Aleihem ha'olam omed. The world is standing on the shoulder of these people. Ketzet ha'shemesh b'gvurato, Chazal says. It's like when the sun comes, it's like the gvura of Hashem, this is this person. Tole eretz al blima. The whole world is hanging al blima. What does it mean, blima? Al adam shebolem et piv bishat meriva. Who give the power to the world, to the earth, to stand in space, Hashem say. People who have what to answer, and they trust me, and they don't answer back. Which is very big test, very big. So he said, what's the point when I answer? I get you more upset, and then we fight. What's the point? Let me get what I deserve and finish. So he said to him, but that's the point, you don't deserve it. He said, it doesn't matter. In the end, Hashem gives everyone what they deserve and not. And if they got more punishment than what they deserve, Hashem will make it up to them. Relax. Hashem runs the world. So he was so impressed by him. He said, I want to stay in touch with you. They exchanged telephone number. And then the Haredi told his wife the story. He said, let's invite them tomorrow to come for tea, coffee. So he invited him. And slowly, he made him religious. And the guy became Haredi. So one day when he became Haredi, he said, listen, my dog died. I heard that it's mitzvah to make a shul if the father died or something for his memory. I loved my dog very much, Igor, poor Igor. I don't sleep at night. Can I make the shul for Igor? So they went to one of Gdolei Ador. And said, I want to make a shul for this Igor, the dog, and to call it Bet Knesset Igor. So the rabbi said, what's the problem? Nobody knows Igor is a dog. It's not Chilul Hashem. I think Igor was a Russian Jew. There's a lot of... Bet Knesset Igor! Next time you go to Chulon, remember, Bet Knesset Igor. That's called Kiddush Hashem. I'll give you another example. There's one Haredi in Bnei Brak. On Shabbat, his son has high fever, very high fever. High fever, it's a life risk. You don't know. Fever, it's only the symptom. You don't know what the problem that caused it. It could be something minor, it can be something serious. You don't take a risk. 1% chance that a person has a risk, you must mechalel Shabbat for him. Must. Not maybe. Must. So now, when the Haredi saw that his son has high fever, right away, he called a doctor. He checked in the phone book, saw a doctor in the area. He dialed the number, the doctor picked up the phone. Yes. So my son has very high fever, can you come check him? What's the address? He gives him the address, he shows up. Chiloni, not religious. He comes, he checked the boy. After all that, it's in the middle of Shabbat. He said, don't worry, I leave you some medicine here. The boy will be fine in a day or two. Give him 3 times a day. Baruch Hashem, he will be fine. So he said to him, okay, I appreciate it. Thank you very much. So the doctor said to him, 500 shekel, please. In the middle of Shabbat. Not religious, what does he care? Shabbat is a weekday for him. So he tells the Haredi, 500 shekel, please. Now the Haredi has a very big dilemma. He said, if I'll tell him, I'm sorry, I cannot pay you at Shabbat. He doesn't know the laws of Shabbat. Right away, what he's going to think? Oof, this Haredim playing games, cheating, stealing, don't want to pay. I did the job, he doesn't want to pay me. It's going to be a big Chilul Hashem. He doesn't understand and not allowed to write a check. If I pay him, I violate Shabbat. What's worse? Mechalel Shabbat or Chilul Hashem? It's a catch-22. So he's thinking. He has an idea. So, okay, wait here. He takes the checkbook out of the drawer with his mouth. He takes the pen with his mouth, and he wrote Aleph. Aleph. One word, Aleph. On where the amount, instead of Chamesh Me'ot, he wrote Aleph. One word, instead of two. With his mouth. With the mouth is rabbinical violation. Isur de Rabbanan. Because it's not the regular way of writing. So he said, okay, I do Isur de Rabbanan to prevent horrible sin of Chilul Hashem. So the doctor see, it says Aleph. He told him, I'm sorry, I told you 500. So he told him, let me explain to you something. I'm really not supposed to pay you today. It's Shabbat. And we're not allowed to write on Shabbat. It's one of the 39 restrictions in the Shabbat. It's a horrible sin to violate Shabbat. It's the covenant. It's the eternal covenant between us and our God for eternity. It's not a joke. But I already knew that you're not familiar with the laws. And if I would tell you come tomorrow for the check, you get upset. And it's also not good. So the more letters I write, the bigger the sin is. Every two letters is a new sin. Shnei otiot. So I rather write Aleph, which is one sin, because it's only three letters. It's not four. Four would make it two sins already. But three letters is one sin. Then to write Chamesh Me'ot, which will become three sins. So I don't care. So the doctor told him, but I don't understand. Look how poor you are. It's in a tiny apartment, everything broken. And this doctor is fancy doctor from Tel Aviv. So he said to him, but you don't look to me someone who can afford to give a tip 500 shekel. It's so important to you this, not to write. He told him, yes, there's a boss to the world. He's in charge of the money anyway. If you go against him, he'll take the money in a different way. So what's the point? He took the check and left. Motzei Shabbat, the doctor is on the door. He gives him a check, 500 shekel change. He said, this is your change. He said, come, let's have a tea together. Started to talk, he made him religious. He made the doctor religious. Became friendly, one thing leads to another. He started to prove to him, show him the Torah min ha-shamayim. So what reward the Jew got before the reward in the afterlife? That already there's a doctor right now that keeps everyday mitzvot, go to learn, and perhaps he will have children and grandchildren. There will be hundreds of Jews keeping mitzvot. Every mitzvah they do go to the account of this Haredi for one mitzvah that he did l'shem shamayim. And believe me, 500 shekel for Avrech, it's food from his mouth. Food, bread from his mouth. No question about this. It's not someone who has $1 million, 500 shekel, kaparat avonot. Avrech, 500 shekel? So what do we see here? That when a person shows Hashem that the truth is above everything, Hashem acts accordingly. No surprises. What comes the wrong way, goes the wrong way. What comes the right way will have blessing for eternity. Chachamim say, some mitzvot has mazal, some mitzvot do not have mazal. What does it mean mitzvah has mazal? What does it have to do with mazal? So the Chachamim give an example which mitzvot have mazal. Mezuzah. Mitzvah with mazal. Almost every Jew has mezuzah. Almost everyone has mezuzah. You see, you go to places, the people completely secular. Completely. They eat on Yom Kippur. Mezuzah they have. How can it be? A mezuzot, it's not cheap. It costs money. It's a lot of work. They still put mezuzah. It's not religious. You ask, you believe in God? No. But he has mezuzah. Thousands of cases like this. Mezuzah, mitzvah with mazal. Another mitzvah with mazal, brit milah. Against all odds. Brit milah. Brit milah should have been the last mitzvah the Chilonim wants to keep. The last. The last. Why? Imagine you take a Chinese guy. Hey, Mr. Lee, come here. I want you to do something nice. What? when you have a baby tomorrow, Mr. Chang, take the scissors and take his ear and cut it in 8 days. So he said to you, what? He said, take the scissors, take it. You know, this ear, you don't need it. You can manage without it. Just cut. Don't worry. You put a band-aid, everything will be fine. So he said, why should I do such a thing? He said, it's very big mitzvah. God loves it very much. Do you think he would agree to do it? He doesn't even believe in God. He's going to cut a piece from his baby's... I once wrote a letter to Tommy Lapid. I wrote to Tommy Lapid. I wrote to him, he's such a hypocrite. You constantly bash the Torah and the religious people. And it came to my attention that you made Brit Milah to your son Yair. I will send a letter to the Attorney General asking him to arrest you for attempted murder. Why? You declare that the Torah is nothing. The Torah is not a divine document. Therefore, you have no source that allows you to take an innocent, poor baby, 8 days old, and cut a piece from his body. That's an attempted murder, and in every country, they put you in jail for 20 years for it. If there is justice, based on your own words, you have to spend the rest of your life in jail. Of course, he never answered me. You're laughing? I'll tell you a story. You know, this Tommy Lapid, when he went to the Knesset, he got 15 mandates. You remember that or not? A mandate, I think, is 30 or 40,000 people. So that means he got more than 500,000 people in Israel, in a country of 6 million Jews. 500,000 from 6 million, you're talking a huge piece. It's not, it's a large percentage, almost 10%. The only thing he suggested to do is to destroy Judaism. That was his agenda. Nothing else. We want to fight for this, for that, everything against Torah. Transportation on Shabbat, transportation on Yom Kippur, that the Haredim won't get money, we close all the yeshivot, we don't give budgets to anyone. That's all he wants. That's why they voted for him. One day, they told me, there is a place that they're seeding Shiva Lo Aleinu. There's 150 chilonim from today to today. Are you available tonight? That was maybe, I don't know, 12, 14 years ago. I don't remember exactly, but a long, long time ago. I say, yes, I'm available. Come quickly. So I drove to New Jersey. I come to the house. I see 150 chilonim. They all came to pay respect to one of the friends that there's a woman. Her father died, married woman. So they told me, come, give a lecture. So I started to give a lecture. I speak the difference between Judaism to the 80,000 religions and cults, the 80,000 fake religions that came after Judaism. How do we know 100% that we are the only nation who has a divine document, that we receive it from God, and their document, it takes 5 minutes to prove that it's fake. That was the topic. I begin to talk. And I see an Israeli guy with a long ponytail sitting right there on the left. And he goes like this to me. You know, the lecture is in Hebrew. They're all Israelis. Tachlif nose. Change the subject. I said, this chatzuf? He tells me what to talk about? I go even harder. So he said, Amarti lecha tachlif nose. I told you, change the subject. I continue to talk. We got the Torah in our Sinai. We have millions of witnesses. We all heard the voice of God. Their religion, someone came and told the story. Nobody ever witnessed it. Their books is full of errors. I begin to say in the Islam, this guy tell me, what are you doing? Tachlif noset. All of a sudden, the guy who sits next to the guy with the ponytail, big guy, he got up, he takes the yarmulke off, throw it to the basket. And he say, I'm leaving. I thought he's going to kill me. I'm leaving. He looks at them, mamash, like a show. Shame on you. He started to scream in Hebrew. Tidbayshu lachem. You have such a religion and you don't keep it? If I stay here 10 more minutes, I will convert to Judaism. I got the shock of my life. Now I realize why he keep telling me, Tachlif Nosek. What was he? Druzim, they mingle with Israelis, you know? They speak Hebrew with perfect Israeli accent. You look Israeli, I see Yarmulke on Israel. How am I supposed to know he's a goy? Then, from all the people, the one who was trying to save him was the guy with the ponytail. He looks at him. You! Tell the rabbi where you're going after this lecture. Tell him, if not, I'll tell him. So one person told him, if you're such a gibor, why don't you stay and convert? Why are you running? He say, I wish I could. They'll kill me in a kfar. They'll kill me. I'll be finished. And he left. Unbelievable. So, mitzvot, brit milah, mitzvah with mazal. Doesn't make sense, but the chilonim keeps it. What mitzvah doesn't have mazal? Nida. Such a horrible sin, one of the worst sin in history, and almost nobody wants to keep it. Shabbat, mitzvah without mazal. 70-80% do not keep it. Some mitzvot do not have mazal. The Chazal say, Akol talui b'mazal, afilu sefer Torah sheba echal. Mazal means a supervision, ashgacha. You have 9 sifre Torah in a shul. 3, 3, and 3. When they put the sifre Torah after they clean the echal, they don't care how they put them. They put yours in a third floor. So now nobody touch it all here. You don't need a sefer Torah. And because somebody decided to put yours in the third floor, it's too high. So they rather take from the first floor. So only the first 3 are used. The other ones, once a year, they have to open them up to refresh them. So you invested 50,000. Your friend, his Sefer Torah is used. Yours is not used. Even that is a kol b'ashgacha. One time, there is a mohel in Israel, his name Abu Av. Rav Mordechai, listen to this, you're going to love this story. Rav Mordechai is a mohel. Yeah, very good one. Yes, I heard, Baruch Hashem. So it says like this. There is mohel Abu Av. He get a phone call. Listen to this story. If you never heard it before, it was worth it for you just for that to come. So this Abu Av, one day he get a phone call. A woman from Tzfon Tel Aviv. Woman from Tzfon Tel Aviv. I see everyone is hot here, not only me. So maybe it's a way to lower the heat, if there is a way. I mean, I see other people going like this. That means it's not only me. Huh?
That's what you're saying.
I'm sending the fire to you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I made bracha already. So it says... Abu Av, are you Rabbi Abu Av? Yes. Can you come tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock to do Brit Milah to my son? And Moel usually get the call 4 or 5 days before the Brit. Not tomorrow morning the Brit is. He say, excuse me? Tomorrow morning is the Brit? She say, yes. And why are you only calling me now? I had to come, check the baby. She said, we're very sorry. This is where we live. Just tell me if you can come or not. He said, okay, I'll come. So he goes there in the morning. He comes to a beautiful villa in Tzfon Tel Aviv. He sees 2 cars in the driveway. No other cars in the street. So he comes inside. He knocks on the door. He sees a woman, fancy lady. She opens the door. Oh, you the rabbi? Yes. Okay, listen. The baby is in the room. And the check is on the table. Do me a favor, when you finish, the babysitter is cut 8 o'clock. Just stay with the baby. I put it under the table. If you don't mind, to stay a few minutes until she shows up. And he said, well, where are you going? She said, my husband already left to work, and I'm leaving to work also. So he said to her, so nobody here in the Brit? She said, no, why? You need us here? You need Asir? He doesn't know what to, if to laugh, to cry. He gets the shock of his life. So he said, but I don't understand. Why you only decided yesterday to call me? She said to him, listen, until yesterday we didn't want to do Brit. You don't believe in this religion, you know. But then my husband said, what happened when he joined the army? He's going to be in a shower in front of all the soldiers. He's going to be embarrassed. You know? So we have to do it. For him, we don't want him to be embarrassed. Okay, religion, no religion. So we decided yesterday to do it anyway. Do you mind? So okay, okay, you can go. What is she going to do? Tashli minyan? So he stayed alone in a villa. He goes to the room, he sees this baby in there. So he said, first time in my life, I was the sandak. I was kiseh shel Eliyahu. I was amida lebrachot. I was the moel. I was everything. So he said, when I cut, so the baby was screaming and crying, and I could not hold my crying, how the nation of Israel became. How a Jew does not even understand what Brit Milah is when people gave their life not to in the time of the Romans, when they say you're not allowed to do Brit Milah, how people risk their life to do it. And in a Holocaust, in places like this, that with such a life risk, in freezing weather, hiding in a forest, doing Brit Milah in Russia. I one time gave a ride to Moel from Russia. He told me I walked 3 days in the snow up to my hips to do Brit Milah. I was against the law. We had to go to a place under the ground. I was walking in a forest that nobody will catch me with the bag, with the tools. I could not go on the main road. 3 days I walked in snow up to here in a forest, hoping I'm going to find a place because I know I go north. By the time of the forest, who knows where I'm going to end it up to make it on time to the Brit Milah. So this Abu Av, he said, I was crying how the nation of Israel became, and the baby is crying from the pain. And he say, my tears falling on his tears. Okay, that was the end of it. The maid came, the babysitter. Okay, then he went home. 13 years later, he got a phone call. Are you Rabbi Abu Av? Yes. Do you remember me? One time you came to our house and you made the Brit Milah in the bedroom to my son. How can I forget you? I have a nightmare from you 13 years. So she said, listen, the boy has a bar mitzvah, and we don't know anything about this. Can you come and teach him for the bar mitzvah? Maybe you know how to teach him for the bar mitzvah. So I said, of course, I'll come, I'll teach him for the bar mitzvah. So he came, he taught him for bar mitzvah. The boy, he loved Torah, loved Judaism. Speaks to him, the boys, how come this, how come that? He saw the boy's potential. 3 years later, the boy is 16, she called for the third time. Are you Rabbi Abu Av? Oh, not again, you again. Say, yes, what now? She said, I don't know, my son became crazy. I want you to talk to him. He wants to leave the school and go to yeshiva. Maybe you talk him out of it. We're not religious. What are we going to do if he goes to yeshiva? So he went, he spoke to him, he convinced them, give him a chance, he'll go to yeshiva. He took him to yeshiva. The boy went to yeshiva. So Abu Av said, my tears and his tears got mixed that day. I was crying for this boy, blessing him, poor kid. This is how he starts his life, and the tears helped. Hashem shama et p'chiyato, sha'are dima lo ninalu, Chazal say. Sometimes we can pray and pray and pray for a month, nothing helps. And then you cry 1 hour, 2 hours later, the problem is over. I have a friend, he's not Gdol Ador, he's not the chief rabbi of London, he's not the chief rabbi of New York, he's a regular religious guy, regular, ordinary. But he has one thing that most people don't have. When he has a problem, he enters the room and he begins to scream with tears that if you stand over there, your blood freezes. How he cries to Hashem. And usually, within a day, always his problems are going away. His mom, I say, working for me like a computer. I go into the room, I begin to scream and cry for hours. The problem is over. Before you even realize. Where does it say that that's the way it should be?
קרוב השם לכל קוראיו, לכל אשר יקראו באמת. קראתי בכל לב, what we scream in the end of יום כיפור, קראתי בכל לב, I tear my heart apart. We scream to Hashem, קראתי בכל לב, answer us. Chazal asked, if the gate of tears did not get locked, why you call it a gate? It's an entrance, it's always open. Gate is something you lock and open, lock, open, lock, open. That's a gate. If it's always open, it's a shar. It's knisa, it's not a gate. So the answer is, sometimes it gets locked. To who? Someone that all his life cried for nonsense, when he needs to cry for something that is really important, this gate is locked for him. But someone who only cry for real things, Shari Dima are always open for him. For him, they're not locked. Why? Because he cried for things that he should cry for, not for $50 ticket that he got. Hashem, they tore my car! No, so you go, you release the car, you do tshuva for something you did wrong, and finish. What are you crying for this? Cry that your kid is not learning Torah. Cry that you have a kid wants to marry who knows who. Cry that, chas v'shalom, there's so many tragedies, every 10 minutes I get a call, pray for him, pray for this, another case, another cancer, another problem, another house is broken, another kid is off the derech. This, for this you have to cry. For the important thing, not for nonsense. I'll tell you something. You know, Rabbi Yehuda Anasi, we spoke about it before, he wrote the Mishnah. The Gemara tells us that he suffered for 13 years. His kidneys was killing him from pain. He suffered so much that he screamed. And he had horses, I told you, he was a billionaire. So every time he had an attack, you know what a stone in a kidney is. I hope you never know. But it's horrible. People scream, they fall on the floor. If it's really hard, a big one. So he begins to scream, and before he starts to scream, he tells the people who work for him, give food for the horses, because when you put food by the horses, they make a lot of noise. He doesn't want the people outside of his house to hear how the rabbi scream, that they don't get upset. Because in the old days, when the rabbi scream, everyone scream and cry with him. Not today, some people say, magia lo. Very good. Unfortunately. So what happened? 13 years, he has pain. Why he got the pain, the Gemara says. One time, there was a calf, a baby cow, calf, that came to him and was trying to hide under his dress because it was taking him to be slaughtered. So he pushed him. He said, go! Ki lekach nivreta. Go, because you were created to become a steak. What do you think you came from the world for? To eat grass all day? Some people eat grass, some people do something else with that. But bottom line right now, you came to become a steak. So Hashem got very upset. It's true. He came to become a piece of meat on a Shabbos table. He didn't say anything wrong. Say no mercy from a rabbi. After all, the animal is going to be slaughtered. It's not a joke. He got the pain right away. 13 years later, he saw the maid sweeping the floor. And there was mice, you know, because the floor was sand. Now it wasn't like today, beautiful marble. It was sand. So she sweeped with the sand. And the mouse, she play golf. You know, the maid, she thinks she play golf. She makes the mouse fly. So he comes to her and says, hey, what are you doing? You don't know the Torah says, Verachamav al kol ma'asav? Verachamav, Hashem has mercy on everything he created. Jews, non-Jews, animal, everyone. I didn't know when they take the calves for slaughtering, they play music.
So anyway, Hashem Rabbi told her, "V'rachamav al kol ma'asav." Stop making the mice fly like this. The Gemara said that day the pain went away. I want to ask you a question. 13 years, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi was screaming from pain. 13 years. He did not have slichot from Rosh Chodesh Elul to Yom Kippur every year. 40 days. Chatanu lefanecha. People think it's like a Miami boys choir. I knew a guy, not religious. He calls me every year, about a week before the slichot begins. His neshama feels the slichot. He said, when the slichot starts? I say, Tuesday. What time? 6:30. He leaves him 40 minutes ride. Can I come? I said, of course you can come. But why someone like you is not keeping Shabbat, not keeping mitzvot, care about slichot? He said, I love the music. He loved the songs. But we also like this. Oh, beautiful singing. So Rebbe did not sing. Rebbe meant slichot. Lev nishbar venitke elokim lo tifze. He was really, really crying in a slichot. And every day he did three times chatati, aviti, pashati. And all his 13 years he learned Torah non-stop. And he wrote the Mishnah. And he gave tzedakah non-stop. And he was praying, rocking the worlds of heaven. And 13 years the pain did not go away. When did the pain go away? When he corrected his midah ra'ah that he had. He did not have mercy on animal. For his level, it was already a problem. For us, we have a lot bigger problems to worry about. But in his level, something, one thing he did not do right, and Hashem sent in this pain. And all the tefillot, and all the slichot, and all the Talmud Torah, and all the tzedakah, and all the zikui arabim did not help him to get rid of the pain. One little word that he said to the maid, have mercy on the mice, the pain went away. What do we learn from here? And we'll finish with that. And if you have some questions. What do we learn from that? A person can be Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai in his level. But if he has one midah ra'ah, he must fix it. Doesn't matter you know all the Torah by heart. Doesn't matter you bal tzedakah. Everything is important, of course. Don't get me wrong. Every mitzvah counts. You can do billions of mitzvot, and you die angry, you did not fix your neshama. You do billions of mitzvot, you die stingy, you didn't fix your neshama. You do billions of mitzvot, you die not modest, the way you dress and the way you behave, you did not fix your neshama. You do billions of mitzvot, you speak Lashon Hara. Not only you do not save your neshama, you destroy your neshama. With all the mitzvot, because Lashon Hara, it accumulates to millions. Bottom line, everybody has to focus on the weaknesses that he came to the world with. Not everyone is not modest. Some women are, some women aren't. The one that have this weakness to show their body in public, they have to focus on that every second of their life until it stops. That's the main thing in the life of a woman. The Gemara say, in Masechet Sota, page Bet, Amud Bet, the Gemara say, Amar Rish Lakish, Mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav. A person get his wife according to who he is. Rashi writes, Nua la tzadik, Prutza la rasha. Modest to the tzadik, to the righteous man, and unmodest to the wicked person. Everybody asks, what's going on here? You should have said, wicked woman to the wicked man, righteous woman to the righteous man. That's how it is. Why they say, modest to the righteous, not modest to the wicked. Why? By women there's no righteous? Only modest? The answer is yes. 90% of the purpose of the woman in life is to be modest. That's it. Everywhere in the Tanakh, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu praised the women, it was only about one thing, modesty. They did tons of chesed. Hardly ever you hear about it. They also kept Shabbat. You don't hear a word about it. They did so many things. You don't hear about it.
Rivka, Tznua, hiding between the camels that they don't see her walking. Rachel, Tznua. Sarah Imenu, Avraham did not know who his own wife, the most beautiful woman in the world. Why? Modest. Esther, modest. Shaul HaMelech. Why Shaul HaMelech had Esther, his granddaughter? Because he was a modest man. Even a man, modest. Everything modesty, modesty, modesty. The Torah is highlighting the matter of modesty, especially by women more than anything else. Why? Elohim sone zima. Hashem hates lack of modesty. Vera'a becha erva davar veshav me'acharecha. Mixed parties, wedding, mixing, touching each other, dressing not modest, hugging, kissing, family, cousins, neighbors. Hashem runs away from this wedding. Pasuk b'Torah. Vera'a becha erva davar, Hashem see. V'aya machanecha kadosh. It has to be holy. Holy means men separate, women separate. It has to be. If it's me, Moshe Rabbeinu made a party to the men. His sister Miriam to the women. Right after Moshe, Vatikach Miriam, right, Anviya, Tatupim, and Nanashim, Umchulot, and she took them to another place and they make a party. Why they didn't make a party together? Miriam and her brother Moshe, mwah, mwah, you know, Kadima, come here. What happened? Because it's against the law. When you see the two most legendary prophets, Moshe, the greatest prophet, and Miriam, the Neviah, you don't rely on them. Believe me, if it was allowed to make a mixed wedding, they would also make a party to thank Hashem together. The women would scream, kulululululu, and everything with the drums and dancing like this all night. But Hashem did not allow it. Sometimes we want to do things. We like to do things, but Hashem doesn't like it. A real kosher Jew puts what I like in the closet, closes it very tight, and does what Hashem wants. Batel retzoncha mipnei retzono. Make sure that you always do what He wants, not what you want. If you do what Hashem wants, then your way to heaven is express. If you do what your stomach wants, who knows what's going to be. That's the truth. I didn't write the Torah. Nobody asked my opinion. Hashem did not call me, hey, Mizrachi, wake up. I have a question. What do you think? What do you think? I should let Mechalel Shabbat be perfectly in heaven with Moshe Rabbeinu together? You think it's a good idea or I should be strict with him? You think I should give the women discount that the skirt can be all the way up or it should be below the knees? What do you think? He didn't ask me. Maybe if he asked me, I already knew the struggle that I have every day. I would try to make myself an easier job. I say, Hashem, I have a suggestion. Cut this, cut this, cut this. Why? Well, maybe people would be more interested. But nobody asked me. Nobody asked me. We'll give some time for questions before we finish. Any questions about what we spoke? Yes.
First of all, I would like to thank you for your speech, and I have learned quite a bit from you today.
Thank you very much.
And of course, I did, the applause will help.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions, if I may. If I start with the first one.
Yes.
The story of the car accident when somebody got hit from the back, and
yes,
the man got a slap, and got another slap, and they got another slap.
Yes.
If the Jewish people keep on getting slaps in Israel, we wouldn't have Eretz Avotenu here.
Right.
Because we were surrounded by so many people, and they all want to keep eat us alive. And if we don't defend ourselves, we wouldn't have the state of Israel today, would we?
You know, your question is a little bit problematic. I tell you why. If you stick to the text of the Torah, you are wrong. If you follow the reality, you may be right. Let me explain. Then in the Torah, it says clearly that everything that we have, Hashem gives us. When we win the war, Hashem wins the war for us. Hashem ilachem lachem v'atem tachrishun. I do everything for you. If you lose, it's because I wanted you to lose. If you win, it's because I wanted you to win. Yes, you need an army. You need to do ishtadlut.
You need to have good air force, you need to have good weapon, everything is true. Just like you have to go to work to make some ishtadlut. But don't ever forget that you do 1 or 2% and I do 98 or 99% for you. Now wait. Let me explain to you now what it is. We have two ways to get what we want. The hard way or the easy way. The hard way or the easy way. I say today in my lecture in Odio Sefcha in the morning, I say there's something that we say in Israel, in the army. What do we say? Ma shelo ba derech harosh, ba derech haraglaim. What doesn't come through the head, when you're supposed to understand in 1 second, comes through the legs. All night you run, you get punished in the army. Tomorrow when the commander tell you do it in 60 seconds, you do it in 50 seconds. Why yesterday took you 70 seconds? Because he didn't take it serious. Now they make you run all night with heavy weight on your back. All night you run. Tomorrow when he tell you 60 seconds, you do it. The way of the Jewish people, history show, as the Torah say, am ksheorev, stiff neck. Everything has to go the hard way. The Torah says in Parashat Bechukotai, if you listen to me, if you follow my instruction, if you keep my covenant, I will make sure no goyim will ever attack you. You will always have peace in the land. Cherev lo ta'avor ba'artzechem. No one would make a beep. When you run after your enemies, two of you will win 10,000. That's going to be the ratio. Two against 10,000. You can win against the whole world. The little tiny Israeli army, based on this ratio, you can defeat United States Army. If we listen to Hashem, or the Russian army. But when we don't listen to Hashem, there's a list of tragedies that are on the way, God forbid. So now, you made a point. Of course, if we don't listen to Hashem, we have to fight. We have to defend ourselves. We have to do all kinds of things. I have a better solution. Instead of fighting forever, where did it get us? Constantly we die and more and more. Why don't we make peace with Hashem? You know, in Chelem, they had a bridge. They had a bridge, and the bridge had a hole. And every car who came on the bridge fell into the river. So the city of Chelem, they decided, what are we going to do? Cars are falling into the water. So one genius guy said, let's make a hospital by the water that every car who falls down, we send the commando right away to release him and bring him into the hospital. After a week, they saw every 5 minutes another person fall into the water. It cost them millions. So one person came and said, I think I have a better idea. Why don't we invest $10,000, we fix the bridge, and we don't need to waste $1 million a day to save people? That's what I tell you today. If we do peace, make peace with Hashem and we listen to him, we won't have to fight forever and ever and defend ourselves and fight and fight and fight. Everything will get done for us. Nobody will touch us.
You will give us the guarantee.
Not me, the Torah. The Torah gives the guarantee. Listen, it all comes down to if the Torah is from Hashem or not. Not from me. Forget about me. I'm not a factor here. I tell you, you know, many people ask, Rabbi, Hashem say, Ki yevarechecha Hashem elokecha bechol mishlach yadecha. I will bless you in everything you do. So you have to do something. If you do not do anything, I will not bless you. Some ishtadlut you have to do. Make some efforts. So I gave him a beautiful story. You will love this story. One poor person did not eat for 2 days. He's starving. He's dizzy. He sees a beautiful house with a big mezuzah. He says, ah, Baruch Hashem, this rich man, he will give me something to eat. So he knocks on the door. He sees a gvir, a wealthy Jew, open the door. Can I help you? He says, yes, please help me. 2 days I did not eat. I'm about to faint. Give me something to eat, please. So he said, of course I'll give you something to eat. I'll give you something to eat that you will be starved for a week. The poor person came back to life. He said, but I'm a businessman. Nothing by me is for free. I need you to do a job for me, and I will give you anything you can eat. Eat as much as you can. So the poor person said, okay, what do you want me to do? He said, I have a garage. It's very dirty. I want you to take everything from the shelves, clean the dust, put everything like I tell you, and then clean the floor. 2 or 3 hours you walk, and I give you the meal. Now this poor person say, you know, until I finally found a house with mezuzah, snowing outside, such weather, let me do the job, at least I won't die. So he walks 3 hours like a dog. By the end of the 3 hours, he comes, he says, okay, your garage looks like a pharmacy now. Give me the food. He looks at the garage, he says, yeah, you did a good job, I admit, no problem. Your meal is ready. You see this house across the street? He says, yes. Please cross the street. Everything is ready on the table for you. The poor person started to run. I hope he's not fooling me. He walked into the house. Shh. 20 different kinds of fish, chicken, meat, desserts, beautiful wines. Wow, I never saw food like this since I was born, he thinks. Right away, he eats, puts in his pocket, try to find a bag, maybe he can take something for the way. After he stuffed himself, now he has to go. He's about to go, somebody was standing on the second floor, and he said to him, I can't believe it. I never saw in my life such an ungrateful person like you. So the poor person looks up and he said, me, I'm grateful? What did I do wrong? You're about to live without even saying thank you? Nobody here ever ate half of what you ate. And you were about to live without even saying thank you. So he said to him, I don't understand. Who do I have to say thank you to? You have to tell me thank you. Who are you? He said to him, I just gave you all this food. You gave me the food? I work for the food. So he said to him, you work for the food? You came here like a pig and finished the whole food. So he said to him, listen, don't get me angry. I work very hard for this meal. Where you worked? Across the street. I cleaned the whole garage. So the guy said, oh, now I get it. He fooled you also. So what do you mean fooled me? He said, this is a bet amchui. This is a special place for all the poor people to come and eat for free. You didn't have to work. He's taking advantage on all the poor people who ask for food. He makes them work and he sends them to us and we have to give them the food. When the poor person heard that, he started to pull his hair off. I work for nothing. I had this for free. This is the mashal. This is the parable. What's the nimshal? The person upstairs in the mashal is Hashem. The person across the street is the Satan, the evil inclination. The room with the meal, it's the world. And the poor person is us, each one of us. Hashem said to us, trust me, follow my mitzvot, learn Torah serious, be modest, stick to my laws, I guarantee to take care of all your needs. Don't have to work, you don't have to kill yourself, do a little bit effort, a little bit ishtadlut, that's it. I'll bless you in everything you do. There's two ways to make money. One, to go and work 15 hours a day, kill yourself day after day, night after night, and you make money. And there's another way, to go to learn Torah and to trust Hashem without fear. Once Hashem sees you're not worried and you're not afraid, what do we say in the tefillah? Yehi chasdecha Hashem aleinu kaasher ichalnu lach. Your chesed should be on us. The more we trust you, the more you'll give us easily. The less we trust you, the harder it is. So this is the way the life is. The more you trust Hashem, the easier you get it. The less you trust Hashem, which means you fear, you worry about tomorrow, Hashem says, oh, you don't trust me? Go to work. But there's a way. You don't have to clean the garage. You know the food is ready whenever you want. If you're not worried, the food will be ready. That's what happened with the man. Hashem said, don't save man for tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll give you new food. Eat today and enjoy. But some people kept the man for tomorrow. You understand? So we have to protect ourselves today because we don't listen to Hashem. When we listen to Hashem, we don't have to worry about anything. And it's a guarantee in a Torah in 50 different places. Not one. 50 different places in different versions. Hashem say, you be good with me, everything you want I'll give you. In war, in food, in health, in blessing, in giving children, in protecting you from your enemies, bringing you to the land, giving you Beit HaMikdash. We lose a lot for being stubborn. We have to constantly take the patients from the water and bring them to the hospital because we don't want to close the hole. What doesn't come through the head comes from the legs. You got it? More questions? Yes.
Sorry, another question. Another problematic question. You said two things and just now another very nice thing. That we get our money even if we don't work very hard sometimes.
The Torah said, not me.
Okay, you repeated it.
Yes.
And also the other thing you said is very shameful that we go and beg for money. But yet I see a lot of people, they are religious and they beg for money.
Yes.
And these two things contradict each other.
One reason, no problem. Listen, the beard doesn't make you religious. The beard doesn't make a person religious. No. The beautiful hat doesn't make a person religious. The beautiful black clothes does not make a person religious. You know what makes a person religious? Two things. Emunah in Hashem, trust in Hashem without worry, and keeping all the mitzvot. Now, emunah means when you trust Hashem, you don't steal. When you trust Hashem, you don't speak bad against your competition. When you trust Hashem, you sleep very well at night. You're not worried in a week you have the rent and you don't have the money. You trust Him, you never worry. I know in my own life, few people like this that I signed for you, that they don't even worry about making a living 1 minute a year. One person like this was Rav Moshe Malka, Alav HaShalom. Do you know what emunah this person had in Hashem? He would burn $1 million in your face if he know a person who gave it to him stole it. Like this, he'll take the torch and burn it with no hesitation. Somebody, for years, they were giving him money. And the people who were giving him money did something bad to someone. He went to protect that someone against the people who give him money. He gave him home, they give him a mikveh, they give him everything. And he went against them and he told them, all of you are wicked, he's right. So they said to him, we're supporting you for 15 years, you go against us? He said, I'm not going against anyone, I'm going with the truth. I will never step in your place, not in your shul, not in a mikveh, not in a house. And he left and he gave up all the money for the truth. And what happened? Do you know what happened? The Syrians, which are much, much wealthier than where he was, grabbed him and gave him 10 times more. Why? That's the way the life is. Some people don't trust Hashem. Did you ever hear that religious person sometimes steal? How can it be? How can it be that sometimes knows that Hashem is feeding him, would still have to go and get something that doesn't belong to him? The answer is, he doesn't believe in Hashem. He has a beautiful beard, but he doesn't believe in Hashem. Someone that trusts Hashem. Okay, I tell you a story that happened in our yeshiva. Not a true believer. I tell you something that happened in our yeshiva. We had a guy in a yeshiva. I'm telling you the name. Go and check. His name is. No, for good. No, I tell you for good. His name is Lior Edri. Lior Edri is a Baal Tshuva. I got permission from him to use his name. You can relax. So Lior Edri was a chiloni one day. One day he became Baal Tshuva and he came to our yeshiva in Monsi. 2 or 3 years he's in yeshiva. He has such emunah in Hashem, better than big rebbes. Big rebbes, that some of them have many millions of dollars in their bank account, don't have half of the emunah this Baal Tshuva had. I'm signing on it with no hesitation. I want to tell you what kind of Baal Emunah he was. He doesn't have a penny in his pocket. All he does is learn Torah and serving the guys in yeshiva. One day he walks in the street. All he has, everything he's worth, is $100 in his pocket. That's all his money. A poor person comes to him and says, I have a big problem. Can you help me out? He took the only $100 that he had, Bachur Yeshiva, and he gave it to him. He told me, do you know what happened a minute after? I walked by the gas station on Main Street. I look at the floor, I found $100. A minute after, I gave the guy all my money. Hashem sent me right away the money plus the reward in the afterlife. That's besides. One day, the parents of Lior Edri came to visit him in Monsi for 2 weeks in Yeshiva. They took a place to sleep. His parents religious, but not Bachurei Yeshiva. Not in his level. One day before they fly back to Israel, his father told him, Leo, we have 4 big suitcases. And you need to take us in a 5 in the morning to the airport from Monsi to JFK. It's almost 2 hours ride in the morning, more even. We need a minivan. We cannot get a small car because it's you, your mother, and me. His father telling 3 people, plus 4 big suitcases, 2 for each. Do you have an idea how you're taking us tomorrow morning to the airport? So Leo Edri told him, Hashem Ya'azor. Hashem knows we need a minivan. We have time until the morning. It's 11 o'clock at night. They're going to sleep. 5 o'clock in the morning when everyone is snoring and it's still dark outside, they have to leave Monsi. And he doesn't have a key, and doesn't have a car, Bichlal, he doesn't have. So he said to his father, we still have 6 hours. Yeshuat Hashem keref ayin. V'ata noten lahem et ochlam be'ito. Hashem gives you what you need when you need. Not the year before. Relax. His father going crazy. What kind of foolish son I have? What happened to him here? They made him crazy. What can he do? He's going to fight with him? So Hashem, the father, Hashem help us not to miss the flight. How are we going to get to the airport? They went to sleep. Leo Edri tells me now the story. And soon I'll tell you how I know everything is true. He told me I didn't have no idea where I'm getting a minivan. No idea. So Hashem, I pray to Hashem. Hashem, you know I need a minivan. Please don't make me disappoint my parents. Help me out by the morning to find a minivan. 5 in the morning. What's the chance? 1 to 1 billion maybe. 5 in the morning is in a mikveh. In Yeshivada's mikveh in a basement. He's in a mikveh. Another person come, Gilad Busi, also Avrech in Yeshiva, on the side is doing car dealing, buy and sell cars. Once in a while, he buy a car, sell, to make a parnasa. He comes to the mikveh, 5 o'clock. They bought in the mikveh. Lior tells him, Gilad, you have an idea where I can get a car? Doesn't tell him minivan. You have an idea, I have to take my parents now to the airport and I don't know what to do. Gilad say, here, take from my pants, there's a key. I just bought a car, there's a dealer plate on it. You can use the car. He grabbed the key, comes out, minivan. He said to his father, here, the minivan is ready, come. He puts the suitcases, he takes them to the airport. You know this what emunah this guy has? He said, I was sure that Hashem would send me the minivan. And Hashem sent him the minivan. To you and me, he wouldn't send. You know why? Because before we sleep, we will be so nervous that we won't have the minivan. Hashem said, oh, you don't trust me? Go and find your own minivan. You trust me? I'll give you everything you want. You understand the rule?
May I tell you a similar story?
Very good. Let's hear it. Baruch Hashem. Now we're training speakers. Please take CDs on the way out, please. And give to your friends also. I brought a lot of CDs.
I have a very good friend.
Yes.
He is a rabbi in Jerusalem. And he comes to visit me every 6 months. And we have dinner together, lunch, etc. He's a good friend and old friend. And we were sitting in a restaurant in Club Kosher in Temple Fortune. And he said, can you take me to the airport? I said, fine, we have time. So after the lunch, he said the prayers after meal. Okay, then we go in the car. I'm driving to Heathrow. I thought he's going to Heathrow.
Oi.
So I'm 3/4 way to Heathrow. He tells me, my flight is from Luton. No, from Gatwick. I don't know where he said from. I said, Gatwick? I don't even know the way to Gatwick. Gatwick is very far. Anyway, I asked somebody on the way how to go to Gatwick, blah, blah, blah. And he said, you are very far, you are a long way. It doesn't end up meeting and missed a flight. Long story short, he got me to how to go to Gatwick. On the way to Gatwick, he tells me, Morris, stop on the left. Stop on the left. We don't have time. We're going to miss the flight. No, stop, don't worry. He opens the car, and he gets, and he starts playing. I don't know, it was Mincha, Arvit. I'm not very religious, but he started playing the Mincha, the Arvit. Okay, I'm behind him. I say, Amen. What do I do? What do I know? I'm not very religious. We reach the airport, Gatwick, maybe 10 minutes before the flight. And you know how much security El Al wants before the flight. Somebody comes from nowhere. He tells me, are you Mr. Frankenhaus? He tells me. I said, no, I'm not Mr. Frankenhaus. I am his friend. Where is Mr. Frankenhaus? Here is Mr. Frankenhaus. He takes him from his hand, and he takes him straight to the gate. This is somebody who came to us, I don't know who he is, from nowhere.
Eliyahu Hanavi.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank you very much. Tomorrow evening, the last lecture in London. I mean, we have in the morning a lecture, but in the evening, in Anshei Shalom, Shul, 8:15, what time? 8:15. I'll tell you an amazing story that happened to me on the way here. If you want to hear it, come please on time tomorrow. That's how I'm going to start the lecture. Please take CDs, because by tomorrow we may not have anything left. Grab the CDs. It's courtesy of good people who donate the CD. Thank you very much, and good night.